Okay, good afternoon. I want to welcome you to the next in our series of webinars presented by CUES. My name is Craig Gleckler, and I'm the marketing manager at CUES, and I will be your host for today. Today's topic will be focusing on the why, when, what, and how for inspecting various sewer systems. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our speaker for today's presentation, Mr. Keith Morin. Keith, take it away.
There you go. Hey, hi, everybody. Thank you for joining today. We really appreciate it. And hopefully we'll have a little fun throughout the presentation here. Again, my name is Keith, and I've been working in the water wastewater industry for, 20 years plus. First, I was working for a company where we engineered, fabricated, and supplied flange ductile iron pipe to rebuild and build wastewater treatment plants in many areas of North America, as well as large water distribution plants, such as the Quabbin Reservoir in Massachusetts, Portland Water District, that supplies water to dozens and dozens of communities throughout the southern Maine area, and with the MWRA in the city of Boston, as well as working with new product technologies, such as manhole rehab products and techniques, polyurethane grout pumping for infiltration management and ground stabilization, specialized coatings for various structures and pipe, specialized manhole covers, et cetera, as well as earning my biological wastewater operator's license, and now working with the various inspection products with CUES Pierpoint. So today is talking about inspections. Again, like Derek already mentioned, why do we inspect? When do we inspect? What do we inspect, and how do we inspect? So here we go, continue. So what's a manhole? We'll start there. Well, obviously this is how we access a particular area for inspection. And I'll just read the description here, but obviously you can see that. But a manhole or an inspection chamber is an underground unit constructed to provide access to the utilities like a sewer system, drainage system, et cetera. Hence, with the help of a manhole, underground utilities are inspected, modified, cleaned, and maintained. So we got to get in there somehow. So how long have manholes been around and where were they first developed? Well, right here. First patent for a sewer basin was in 1861, and the patent for a first manhole cover was in 1878, as you can see here. So, during many manhole inspections over the years with me, it's interesting to observe the condition of structure to structure when we're investigating manholes or chambers. Manhole structures in the average, as they're in the streets and on the properties today, are an average of 25 years plus in age. The older structures, obviously mostly fabricated from brick, are in much better shape than the formed concrete structures that we produce and install today. One of the times when I was out doing inspections and that I referred to is I had a series of inspections with the municipality on Main Street, and we were inspecting chamber to chamber. And I think there was over just 20 in this one section on this short section of Main Street where we were investigating. So as we're looking at the structures, we started with these square based brick structures. And when we're investigating that, the bricks and the mortar, the bench, everything was in really nice shape. And as we went, and these things were all over 100 years old in this particular area. And it's amazing how they looked. They were clean, they were nice, and they were structurally perfect. And as we continued down the road, we started getting into the newer formed concrete structures, and those structures that have been installed within the last 25 years were in various states of degradation, walls peeling. It was just phenomenal to see the difference and the stark difference in that. So it makes you wonder, when the guys were out there many years ago doing these things, laying all this stuff by hand, obviously the cost and the labor was a lot cheaper, but the materials that they used or what mortar mix they used, who knows, but some of the older structures are in much better shape still today than some of the newer structures we put in there. So whatever formula they had was a great formula. And you would think with all of the innovations and stuff we have today that they'd be getting better and better, but it's actually the opposite. And I had a meeting relatively short time ago with the Boston, Massachusetts City Roads Commissioner regarding the overall condition of their brick manhole structures in the streets. And what we found doing some surveys through that and their concern in the city of Boston, the bricks themselves are in really good shape. The mortar is starting to degrade and turn into sand. So the city structures are virtually sinking, similar to Venice, Italy. It's pretty amazing. So what's the solution? That's what we were talking about. You know, and obviously the structures that were physically put in there, and not only in Boston, but in cities throughout the U.S., in North America, they weren't originally built to withstand the amount of traffic and the size of and the amount of vehicles that now travel the roadways. So, you know, we're in this juxtaposition of, you know, okay, this stuff exists. What do we do to keep it going for the next 100 years? So not only are manhole covers, essential, functional, necessary, but they actually can be quite beautiful and viewed as pieces of art. There was a time ago, I had met this individual when I was on the road that had an idea. And he actually had a business going. I don't know if he still exists or not. This is several years ago. But he had an idea to use manhole covers as advertising space for cities, trying to convince the cities and towns in the numerous areas for potential advertising revenue sold to various businesses using manhole covers as advertising space. Great idea, because there are so many of them. But, you know, I don't know if that thing ever took off, but you can see here as, you know, just some manhole covers I picked up from around the world. They can be, you know, very beautiful as well as obviously a necessity. So how many manholes are there in the world that we use for access? Well, right now, they estimate in North America, there's an estimated 100 million manhole structures in North America. Kind of reminds you of a piece of Swiss cheese. Viewing that. And through further research, I was just looking at, okay, if there's 100 million manhole structures that we know about that aren't buried and are accessible in North America, how many structures are there worldwide? And they estimate that there are approximately 1.5 billion manhole structures in the world presently. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? So how many miles of pipe are buried in North America? I'll read this through. You know, current estimates state that there are 800,000 miles of public sewers, 500,000 miles of private lateral sewers, 2 million miles of natural gas lines, 321,000 miles of gas transmission and gathering pipelines, and 175,000 miles of hazardous liquid pipelines. And that's just the stuff, you know, we know about that we've actually put in there and, you know, inspected or continue to inspect. So it's pretty, you know, pretty amazing. So, you know, many miles of older pipe obviously have failed or been replaced or rehab with coatings, cured in place pipe or patches. All pipes require pre and post inspection using some form of CCTV camera inspection. Obviously. So about 20% of the U.S. population are on private or septic systems. There are approximately 60 million people on private sewer or septic systems. And obviously, all of these private sewer systems require occasional inspection and cleaning. And with the new regulations in place, a lot of them require inspection prior to the sale or the resale of property. So, wow, you know, That's a lot of things, a lot of areas to inspect. So we've got various things, even on wastewater treatment facilities, the treatment plants themselves, the grit tanks, the clarifiers, the wet wells, all of these structures. You just can imagine the literally millions of structures, millions of miles of pipe to inspect. So there's no lack of the use currently of the CCTV video camera inspection. So there's a lot of stuff that we haven't yet inspected and a lot of stuff that we inspect on a regular basis. So why do we inspect? So here's just some of the reasons. Obviously, to assess overall condition of the system or part of the system, to check on some of the problem areas, to clean sections of the system, to replace, sections of older or damaged areas, and to fix a sudden sewer problem that has created an emergency, or to identify potential problems and address them as part of a routine maintenance of wastewater structure. When do we inspect? I got a story. Obviously, if you see something like this in town, hey, you've got to address that. You've got to inspect that, because we have a nice, beautiful flower of water coming out of that particular manhole. So we inspect when the system isn't operating correctly, obviously, like this picture shows, when a sewage overflow occurs, pre and post sewer inspections, when a system has been repaired or replaced on a scheduled basis for preventative maintenance, or to place the system and components on an asset management program. So all of these reasons, a short time ago, I was working with a municipality somewhere in New England. And we went to a job site that we had to inspect where a sinkhole had developed, and they wanted to go check out why the sinkhole had come up on the side of the road. Now, this was after a lightning strike had hit a utility pole. So when we opened up the structure and we're looking at it, what we found was quite interesting. Several sections of newly installed HDPE drain pipe had melted, collapsed, and fused with the asphalt road through that electrical, that lightning strike on the utility pole. So obviously all of that needed to be replaced. And that was a pretty interesting inspection to do, because there wasn't much left of that pipe. It was all kind of balled up. It looked like, pieces of lava. If you've ever seen that, it was quite an interesting thing. So, as you're doing this and inspecting various locations, it's always interesting what you see. And, a lot of us on a daily basis are doing pretty much, the same thing, the same job, but, always can come across very interesting and unique things that happen to the structures that we generally, and obviously the public doesn't pay much attention to unless it's not working properly. So, and what to inspect? So there are two basic types of inspection and examination. Obviously, you've got direct and indirect inspections. Direct inspection and examination, this means a person walking through a sewer before it is commissioned and physically inspecting the condition. This shall never be done once a sewer has been put into service, but obviously these two gentlemen in these photographs didn't listen to that advice. So what do we inspect? We're looking at the manhole covers and the physical structures, the rim that for INI issues, manhole chimneys for that same effect, manhole chambers, mainline pipe, laterals, storm drain, drainage pipe, tanks, all that sort of stuff to look through. So, these two pictures remind me of something. Obviously, we're inspecting all areas of sanitary and storm drain systems. And this reminds me of these two pictures, because I live in New England, if you guys didn't know that, because I keep referring to Boston and cities around here. It reminds me of what they do to inspect a larger pipe diameter in Boston, where the pipes go out to some of the islands that are close by offshore, within a couple of miles of the shore. And in some of the larger diameter pipes, I've never done this and I never want to, but individuals inspect that pipe, and they still do direct inspections when they stop the flow in these pipes, and individuals strap into these carts and ride out between 2 and 3 miles. Obviously they're in protective clothing. They've got kind of the scuba gear on with the air tanks and stuff. And they travel several miles inside these pipes to directly inspect the overall condition. No thank you for me, but that must be a really interesting, job to have. But, stuff like that still goes on today. It's pretty interesting. So that's, what we inspect, why we inspect, and how to inspect. My God, please, not like this. You see some of these guys here, my God, I hope they got their hep shots, okay? And not to pick on any particular culture, but it is somehow, this just shows how some of the inspections take place around the world. And just through these pictures, I was doing some additional research through this. And in India particularly, obviously where these pictures are from, they estimate that 20% of the personnel that are involved in these inspections in this environment are replaced yearly because of sickness or death. You think of that, man. You know, it's just incredible that that still goes on today. Now, with all of our safety regulations here in the U.S. and our protocols, luckily, no one has to endure anything this extreme. You know, with all of the safety equipment we have for deployment, for retrieval, for fall protection, the air exchanges we use, the gas monitors, you know, I mean, these things aren't so cumbersome after all, are they? You know, it's just amazing what goes on and the difference that we have today. And I know everybody, you know, complains about certain things, but man, have we got it easy compared to this, huh? How'd you like to be involved in something like this? And, you know, this does remind me that there's an outfit here with a it's a family run outfit. There's a guy and his son that still do. They dive into lagoons, you know, because a lot of the municipalities have the lagoons instead of the clarifying tanks and stuff. And he has a business where they suit up and dive into the lagoons to do the physical inspections there. And, you know, I've met them and talked to them on job sites and seen them at shows. Excuse me, throughout the years, let me grab a drink of water here. Pretty interesting career choice. He does make a lot of money, but you got to be a special individual to do stuff like that. So just a little bit different. And, you know, you see how lucky we are. We don't have to do inspections like this. We actually have a lot of products that will help us be a lot safer than what's shown here on this particular slide. But before we get to how, let's take a look at the brief history of CCTV. But after that photo, before that, let's all take a deep breath and enjoy the pretty flowers here, you know, and just be thankful that you don't have to do inspections by diving into the chambers yourself. So let's go on. So the brief history of CCTV, of how we got to where we are today. So the first ever recorded, the live monitoring, Germany, 1942, the first ever recorded use of CCTV. It was designed by an engineer and was used to watch over the monitor and monitor the V2 rockets. This was its first use until 1949 when it became commercialized. And it was this year that Vericon, an American government contractor, started to advertise the technology. These earlier versions obviously could only transmit live video. So someone had to constantly monitor these, and the V2 rocket was the first long-range missile ever developed. And they used these cameras to monitor those rockets at that time. And this is the first use of CCTV in history. And you just look at all the uses that obviously we have today on this. So, you know, pretty amazing. The first Vidicon camera tube. So this sample is an early Vidicon camera tube. The first ones were obviously black and white only with no recording capabilities. So they only had visual. And this is just a representation of one of those first Vidicon tubes that was created in the 40s, early 50s. So the Vidicon tube. The Vidicon is the before the invention of CCD and chips, video cameras used vacuum tube technology to capture images. It was developed in the late 1940s. It was the first low-cost television camera imaging tubes, and they were used throughout the 50s up until the mid 80s. And the camera tubes originally were used by NASA space missions of the 60s, 70s, and 80s to capture the images there. The first color video cameras made by RCA and other companies for television companies used three separate tubes with a red, green, or blue filter to achieve that color. And the first color home video camera with a single image tube was introduced by consumers by Toshiba in 1974. And that doesn't seem that long ago, does it, guys? So before that, it was all black and white, and it wasn't until the mid-70s that we actually had that the color with the video cameras. It's pretty amazing because you think, you know, you're sitting here and you think, man, we've had this technology forever. Well, obviously it hasn't been on around forever, has it? And the vacuum tubes and technologies were replaced by solid state CCD imaging chips in 1984. So not that long ago. It's pretty amazing how far we've come in a relatively short short time in American history. So to continue, obviously, next was the process of how we're going to record this stuff, the video, the primitive video recordings. So they created the reel-to-reel recording system. You know, it was difficult, unreliable, time-consuming, and costly. Then the emergence of VCRs. Remember that? History. All the VCR tapes that we had with all the movies and all that stuff. You know, it was a pretty amazing time. Again, not that long ago that we have actually created this stuff. So the turning point for CCTV technology, obviously, was the emergence of the video cassette recordings in the 70s. Now we're able to run those without someone monitoring it constantly, and we're able to record that information and view it afterwards. Now, it's funny, through my travels through the U.S. and mostly, you know, obviously on the East Coast, I still run into several municipalities that still have that old technology. They've got a few of those old camera systems and stuff that are still using those video, the VCR tapes, which is funny. Some places I go to, and maybe in some of your areas as well, back in the office there in the tomb, you've got shelves full of VCR tapes, you know, with the various numbers of the structures or the pipe that you inspected over the years. And, probably those things are covered with dust and no one looks at them anymore. But pretty amazing that we use that, and we're very happy with that particular technology at that time. And funnily enough, it's still used, today. But after that, next came the multiplexing in the 1990s. It allowed video signals from multiple cameras to be combined and shown on a single monitor. And then, of course, going digital, entering the millennial area. New technology, obviously, been on the rise. VCRs and CCTV systems have been replaced by friendly DVRs, and now NVRs, network video recorders, types of recorders encode and process videos in the camera, then streaming process videos and NVRs to be stored remotely. And now, what are we doing? Types of video inspection. You know, we've got the new technology that we'll go over in a minute, but what's it used for? It's used for sewer and water inspections, lateral inspections and mapping, cross-border prevention and mitigation, water and sewer mapping, and manhole inspections. So it's pretty amazing where we've come. So how do we inspect? So how do we go about inspecting the various infrastructure that needs attention, here at home in the United States? Let's take a quick look. So what we're doing now is, obviously, the technology has come way forward in the past few years, and it's changing, obviously, yearly now with all the technology that we have currently. But right now, on smaller diameter pipe, we're using push rod systems, typically used in smaller diameter pipe between 2 and 12 inch. Many companies offer, camera equipment to accomplish this task. Push rod camera system range in length from 100 to 500 feet normally, the rods being of various stiffnesses to be able to push the various distances required. So you've got your wide variety of push rods for those, the shorter, obviously, runs in the smaller diameter pipe. How do we inspect the larger diameter pipe? Get into the initial ones with the portable crawler systems for larger diameter pipes, generally using used in a diameter pipe from 8 inches to 60 inches, using a variety of crawler bodies, wheel sets, camera heads, and elevators, available in cable lengths, generally up to 1,000 feet in a portable way. This particular design of using portable products enables the end user to deploy the system from smaller vehicles, a pickup truck, an ATV, that type of thing. They're relatively lightweight, easy to use, and extremely portable in various situations. So you can actually walk them down into areas that are inaccessible normally. So a great step forward with these portable type products. How do we inspect the manholes that we have? We have pole camera systems in place now. And these particular pole cameras that we have today They're all available for inspecting manhole systems. They've got recording capabilities, Zoom camera features, various lighting settings to inspect manholes. This particular one shown has the capability of inspecting manholes up to 24 feet deep with, you know, extension poles available for deeper systems. Everything's manufactured out of carbon fiber to make it lightweight, you know, with Wi-Fi capabilities, batteries that will give you a full, you know, a full day's, comes with a, you know, a couple of different batteries, usually about a 4 to 5 hour battery life per. Take a couple of batteries out with you and you can inspect manholes for the full day, you know, gathering that information and be able to put that onto, you know, a different software platform for viewing in the future. You've got various products here. One of the newer technologies is called the Spider. And this is the spherical imagery digitally enhanced rendering to inspect chambers, wet wells, and manhole structures. And this is a pretty fascinating device. This particular device, it looks, and you can go check it out on your own. I just have one photo here of being shown dropped into a wet well structure. But it's very lightweight. It actually looks like a little spaceship. It's pretty cool. It's covered by lights and cameras. And this particular unit weighs about 30 pounds, can be hand carried to difficult areas to access. You can use this as a truck mounted unit or on a tripod for that portability. This can be operated with any tablet or computer which receives Wi-Fi. The output obviously can be used for structural assessment and pre and post rehab analysis. This provides a 190-degree field of view, live video stream, making it an ideal tool for I&I studies. And the way it works, it collects millions of three-dimensional points during the scan. It's pretty amazing what you get when you operate this with the software, the imaging that this thing creates. Like I said, using the three-dimensional points, it's a point-to-point, almost like a pointillism picture, but the points are so close together that it actually looks like a photograph, and you can take this image that it creates in any 3D viewing system, and you can take this, the image that this thing creates, and you can go inside it, look at the exterior of it, flip it upside down, flip it sideways, zoom into any point of the structure to look at any particular defects and stuff. Just absolutely incredible, some of the technology that we've come up with for viewing, you know, manhole structures and various things. So it's really come a long, long way. And if you guys ever get a chance to see something like this, take advantage of it, because not only is the demo and the presentation fascinating, but getting into the software and looking at what you can actually see, the detail that this thing projects is just actually stunning. So to move on, we've got, many, many different ways we do inspections today. This little photograph just shows one specific vehicle just set up to inspect manholes with various products to do that. And, you know, you can use this in a smaller base van. Everything's enclosed in there and go from manhole to manhole and do your inspections by, you know, capturing all the video and saving that for later viewing. We've got full base trucks you can get now from custom TV mainline lateral inspection trucks to do a wide variety of structures, pipe diameters, using various cameras, looking down the lateral pipes off the main. Just amazing what we can capture now with the technology that we currently have. You know, doing it in a safe manner, doing it in a relatively quick manner. Just amazing the scope of products that are available to us today to do all of these inspections is just, you know, simply phenomenal. Interesting fact that I found when, just doing some research and you're looking at all these different things of how we accomplish certain things, pre-inspection camera technology, in order, when they first, you know, started inspecting pipes and the camera systems weren't available and stuff, in order to inspect a smaller diameter pipe with flow, an individual ran some type of line, twine, or rope through a section of pipe with a small raft attached and a lit candle on board. And when the raft was pulled through the section being inspected, if the candle was no longer lit upon removal, it was determined that there was a possible infiltration somewhere in the line. You know, man, we've certainly come a long way from that, haven't we? Just amazing, you know what we've done in history to inspect, to check, make sure things were working properly and stuff. So from that to where we are now is just, you know, simply amazing to me, and I'm sure to you guys too. So what does the future of video inspection actually hold? Future of inspection. It's already here, man. It's here now. One company that I was investigating, it's called Decra. They're out of China. They're the fourth largest inspection company in the world. Decra is incorporating the Elios 2 drone as a tool to complete inspection in areas where it is unsafe for personnel and cost effective. And this is pretty funny to me because about 10 years ago, we're out in the field and, we were doing some inspections and somebody asked me, hey, Keith, what do you think the future of this holds? And I said, hey, it's drones, man. You're not going to use all this equipment anymore. We're going to do it all with drones. And they were laughing at me. Well, here we go. So what's an Elios drone? You can see the drone in the center of that, in the center of the geodesic dome there. And I've got a couple of videos that I've downloaded from YouTube, and hopefully we can get those to work, because I just want to show you a couple of minutes of a couple of inspections they've done using this particular thing. This creation here was created by a Swiss company, and not surprised, because they got great cheese, great chocolate, and now great drones. So this was originally developed for indoor inspection and designed specifically for confined spaces. It's got GPS free stabilization, full HD live streaming, used for close-up inspection, 4K camera, thermal camera, 10K lumens with adjustable lights, and it can remain at set distances when it's inspecting, structures, interiors of structures, drainage areas or physical tanks and stuff like that. It's really a pretty cool thing. And, we don't see much of this here. I know that there's a lot of, drones out there for fun use for photography. Some of the engineering firms that we're involved with use drones for, taking photographs of various land structures and stuff. I know that's in full use now, but nothing that I've seen as far as inspecting pipes and stuff at this time. So hopefully this will be coming sooner than later, but they are using this in various areas. Yes, hopefully you guys can see this. And let's see if we can make this a little bigger and show this particular one for a few seconds here. Now, I got this muted as well, because I'm just going to, let you guys take a look at this just to show the capabilities of this, and hopefully this is working for everybody. And we'll just run this for a minute or so, and then we'll switch to another one, and then we should be just about at the end of our presentation, and I thank you for your time. So this is just showing some of the capabilities and what they what they're using to do some inspections of tanks and obviously confined space. So just take a look at this. A couple of happy gentlemen here are going to deploy the little drone. And the reason that it's in that geodesic dome is obviously to protect it, because it can bounce up against stuff and kind of stay on its flight path to achieve what it needs to achieve. It's pretty amazing what they've come up with. So all this stuff is being obviously used today, and maybe we'll see this sometime in our new future as well. But as this goes into the tank in these different areas, just think of the uses for this coming up in the future. It's just amazing. So it's got the distance locks. You can hold it at a particular distance away from a wall or within a pipe structure. And just think of that going into, chambers, wet wells, different structures. I guess the steering capabilities of these new things are pretty amazing. You can get them to go pretty much anywhere you want using a little held hand device and a little tablet to do all your viewing and recording. So pretty cool stuff. So just watch this for another second here, and then I'll switch to another one and hopefully see that. And then we can kind of wrap it up from there. This is showing right here the use of the Ilios drone in a ship, in the chambers of the ship that they use for, you know, transporting different materials. This one, obviously, liquid materials. And this right here, we'll try to go a little forward, but this is going to show the drone doing big smoke stacks in various areas where you physically can't get personnel in, you know, for the safety of the individual, and just using these drones in areas that you are just normally inaccessible and almost impossible to inspect. And there's one going down a smokestack, and this will end quickly. And then it's going to go into a storm drain application that they couldn't shut down the water flow in this. And they used this this Ilios to inspect the condition of the concrete drainage system, which is just amazing to me, but really, really cool to see. So these obviously can solve a lot of future issues and things we're looking at. So here we go, using that in a drainage area. Pretty amazing. They needed something to inspect that, you know, fast without shutting down the sewers. Obviously, they're saying 5 million cubic meters of water a day. So they've been doing this for a while and, you know, haven't seen anything like that here, but maybe we will in the near future. Let the drone do the job instead of personnel going down in there. Pretty cool. So that's all. I just wanted you guys to see some of the, you know, some of the future technology going on. And that is about it. And let's get out of here and switch back to, there we go. So this, you know, concludes the education portion of this session. And let's see if you guys have any questions, and we'll see what we can answer. And I thank you again for your time and your attendance on this particular seminar. Really appreciate it a lot.
All right. Thank you, Keith, so much. Definitely appreciate that. That does wrap up our webinar. We do want to thank you all for attending today and hope you found value in our presentation. If you have any further questions or would like to talk to someone from CUES regarding sewer inspection systems, please feel free to reach out directly to Keith. His contact details are on your screen. You can also always visit the CUES website for more information. Thank you all for attending.